When it comes to talking about Jordan brand and sneaker culture, we usually only mention Jordan 1 to 14. There's an entire generation and era of Air Jordans that we kind of just forget about. And even though significant technology improvements were made during that time, they were never really quite able to capture the magic and the popularity of the Jordan 1 through 14. So I wanted to do something a bit different that brings those shoes back to light. So I'm gonna rank the Jordan 15 all the way to Jordan 23. And I cut it off at Jordan 23 because that felt like a natural endpoint. After the 23, they went with a different naming system for a while. It went back to the numerical system. So I feel like the Jordan 15 to 23 was like an era to itself. So I hope you enjoy this video. I'd love to know if you agree with this ranking. Here we go. At number 9, it is the Air Jordan 15, designed by Tinker Hatfield. And you can tell they really wanted to do something different. This is the first shoe post MJ's Bulls career. It was supposed to be the 14s, but MJ being MJ, he put on the Jordan 14s in Game 6 of the NBA Finals in 1998. Now, right away, you'll notice that droopy tongue. Now, I've heard two stories behind the inspiration of that tongue. Number one is to resemble MJ sticking his tongue out every time he drove to the basket. It had been a staple of MJ since he entered the NBA. And the second story is it's supposed to resemble people's jaws dropping when they watch MJ play. Now, I actually think that story is on Jordan.com, so that might be the official story. But regardless, it does not look good. I think this whole shoe reminds me of a sock. Going from the shape of the shoe, that droopy part, it reminds me of when a sock, the ankle collar, the thread starts to become loose and it kind of just droops down. That's what it reminds me of, and I do not like it. The upper sole of this shoe is designed by Kevlar, which is like a strong fiber material. This shoe also features a Zoom Air unit both in the heel and the forefoot. So performance-wise, I'm sure it was a great shoe. Obviously, Tinker Hatfield went with something very different for the Jordan 15. And I think he went too different. And for that reason, this shoe is ranked last on my list. Number 8, it is the Air Jordan 19. And I might offend some people because I know there's a group of people who are huge fans of this shoe. This shoe was inspired by a poisonous African snake. And you see on the shroud where it covers up the laces, the texture is supposed to resemble a reptile skin. And the lace cover is made out of a material called Techflex, which is supposed to be very durable, very lightweight. And it also features a carbon fiber support shank, full length zoom unit, as well as Phylon midsole. So the performance of the shoe sounds great. I've never owned a pair. But again, the way this looks, it's just so out there. I don't usually like shoes that covers up the laces, especially the way this shoe covers it up. There's something about that lace cover that just kind of looks like a lid of a basket or something to me. So for that reason, this shoe is number 8 on the list. Number 7 is the Air Jordan 17, and this shoe was the one he wore during his first year as part of the Washington Wizards. This shoe again comes with a cover on the laces, and it was inspired by jazz music. So on the lace cover, you're actually seeing musical notes throughout. I do think that's a pretty cool touch. And unlike the Jordan 19s, this lace cover was actually removable. Now at the time, this was the most expensive Air Jordan ever created, and I can see why. This shoe features a full length carbon fiber shank, a Zoom Air unit in the forefoot, a traditional Air unit in the heel, and it also came with a briefcase that had a CD-ROM in it, going back to the jazz music inspiration. And overall, I don't hate the look of this shoe, but it does kind of resemble like a Team Jordan. The performance of the shoe sounds great, but there's something about it that just makes it look cheap, which is ironic because it was the most expensive Air Jordan. So for that reason, it's number 7 on my list. And number 6 is the Air Jordan 16. And from here to number 1, I actually like all of those shoes. And if any one of them were to be retroed, I'd be happy. But the Air Jordan 16 was the first shoe not designed by Tinker Hatfield after he designed Air Jordan 3 all the way up to 15. And the most distinct feature of this shoe is that detachable flap that you could remove. And this kind of started the trend of detachable flaps for Air Jordan, as you can see from the previous shoes on this list. But I think the way they did this flap actually made the shoe look pretty sleek. So I didn't mind it too much, and it was removable. And the shoe featured a zoom unit in the forefoot with Nike Air in the heel. And overall, I think this shoe is pretty clean. It's very sleek, minimalistic. I think the bread colorway looks awesome on this shoe. And honestly, between this and number 5, I could have flipped them at any time. It was just kind of depending on my mood at the time of the day, which brings me to number 5, which is the Air Jordan 22. Again, like the Jordan 15s, this shoe was inspired by a fighter jet. I remember I picked up a pair of the Jordan 22s at an outlet. They were like B-grade versions, so it looked very off. But I've also seen what non-B-grade actual Jordan 22s look like. And they look nice. They look very nice in person. The stitching of the shoe, which is very unique, and you'll see the whole heel counter comes in that camouflage pattern. This shoe was also special in the way that it used titanium. So the top eyelets, the lace lock, the midfoot shank plate, they all featured titanium. And this shoe featured something called IPS pods, which is something Jordan Brand developed. A pod had multiple densities, So the theory behind it was it provided better cushioning for different purposes. And I do remember playing in the B grade versions that I had of the Jordan 22s. They weren't fugazi, they were just B grade sitting at an outlet, but I remember not being too blown away by them, but that was probably because they were B grade. Overall, I think this shoe is sleek. I like the heel counter that comes in a camouflage pattern. I love when they try something different. Next up is the Air Jordan 18s, and I don't know if it's just me, but the 18s, at first glance, you could kind of mistake it for an Air Jordan 16. It's probably because of the lace cover, but the Air Jordan 18 was the last shoe that he wore on an NBA court, was the final season of his Washington Wizards career, and it was inspired by a sports car. And the Black Royal version actually came with a towel, a toothbrush, kind of like a maintenance kit to clean your shoes, as well as a driver's manual. Why doesn't Jordan Brand do that more widely nowadays? This shoe featured a full-length zoom unit as well as a carbon fiber in the midsole. I believe this shoe returned in 2018, and it came with some really, really nice colorways. And overall, I really like the look of this shoe. And there's something about how minimalistic it is. It's just right up my alley, but it's still not in the top three. And that brings me to number three is the Air Jordan 21. Now I remember this shoe coming out, just how luxurious and premium it looked. And it makes sense. The entire upper sole is made out of full grain leather, not split grain, full grain leather. And this shoe is inspired by the Bentley Continental GT, which is a car, if you buy a new one, starts at about $200,000 and just keeps going up, depending on the options. And the mesh panel on the midsole is supposed to resemble the grille of a Continental GT. And I remember when the shoe came out, there was a red suede version that looks so dope. I love red shoes. I really wish that shoe made a return. I think it still holds up. And the technology on the shoe was amazing. It featured an IPS pod on the heel that you could swap out for a Zoom Air or a more traditional Nike Air unit. It had a carbon fiber shank as well as a Phylon midsole, so it's very lightweight. Now the craziest thing about this shoe, or at least one version of this shoe, is in the white and red colorway, if you shine a backlight onto the backside of the shoe, you'll actually see a message appear. And that was supposed to stop counterfeiting, so on the fakes you obviously wouldn't be able to reproduce that message. And that message is supposed to say authentic. I don't know if fakes actually ever were good enough to be able to replicate that. That's just such a cool feature on a shoe. I kind of wish they still did that. That'll actually make the job of like StockX, GOAT, or eBay easier when they authenticate a shoe. Or maybe it'll just make them redundant because we could do it ourselves. But I do kind of wish they would bring that back. And at number two, I know this might be a little controversial, it probably is number one on most people's list, is the Air Jordan 23. Tinker Hatfield returned for this shoe after not designing the 21 or the 22. And they obviously brought him back because this is a very significant shoe. And for this shoe, Jordan Brand wanted it to be as MJ as possible. One could say they wanted MJ's thumbprint all over it, which they actually did. You can see MJ's thumbprint on the inside of the tongue and the outsole, the traction, that was also meant to resemble MJ's thumbprint. You can also see MJ's signature on the toe box, which I think is just really, really cool. His signature actually looks nice. It fits on a shoe. There are some people's signatures that just don't fit anywhere on clothing or on a shoe, but MJ's, he's just a goat. He just does everything so well. This shoe featured a carbon fiber shank plate. IPS pods were used again. So this is the fourth shoe in a row they use IPS pods. And the stitching of the upper sole is meant to resemble DNA, which is like an homage and reference to having MJ's DNA all over this shoe. I think the Jordan 23s is one of the best looking shoes in all Air Jordans, including 1 to 14. I think it's pretty underrated in the grand scheme of things. There's not really a lot of people talking about the 23s. The most recent version is the Air Jordan 23 Year the Rabbit, which is a shoe that I loved. Unfortunately, they never released in the US. They did release in Taiwan, and I happen to have family there. That's where I'm from originally, but I may be able to get my hands on a pair because of those connections and maybe make a review on the Jordan 23 Year the Rabbit. Looking forward to that one. But overall, the Jordan 23s could have been number one on any given day, but it just got squeezed out by the number one on this list, which is the Air Jordan 20s. The Air Jordan 20 was inspired by motorcycle racing, and the whole look of this shoe is just so different. It's just so unique. You see that floating ankle strap, as well as the strap over the midfoot. And the Air Jordan 20 was actually the first shoe to use laser graphics. That became a hot thing for a while in the 2000s. I still think it looks so dope. My favorite part anatomically of a shoe, the booty of the shoe, you'll see six rings, obviously meant to represent MJ's six championships. Now, along the side of the shoe, you'll see 69 dimples, which is an insane number of dimples to put on a shoe. But that is meant to be a reference to MJ's career high, which is 69. And the Air Jordan 20 not only debuted the lasered graphics, but it also debuted the IPS pod system, which I mentioned in previous shoes on this list. And you'll see a bunch of them on the outsole. By the way, that outsole looks so dope. And the pods are arranged in a way where it's softer cushioning in the heel and firmer cushioning in the forefoot. And part of the reason I put this shoe over the Air Jordan 23s is a little bit of nostalgia. I had a very good friend of mine. He had the red and white version. I used to just salivate over that shoe. I wanted it so much. I really hope it is time for Jordan Brand to bring back the Jordan 20s. And even though I don't love straps that cover up all the laces on a shoe, there's something about the overall design and the shape of this shoe just really speaks to me. And if I could get my hands on a pair of the white and red version of the shoe that my friend had, I'd be happy. So that's it. Thanks for watching Soul Inclined. Let me know what you think of this list. What would you put first? What would you put last? Did you disagree or agree with my rankings? Like, subscribe, comment, all that good stuff. And remember, just remember, wear your shoes.